one kind of application of computer graphics that we're very familiar with is just in entertainment, advertisement, etc. Many of the things that that we see on posters, images on the web, I mean, they're not really photographs anymore. They're made in a computer, potentially using things that have been captured from reality, but it's more convenient often to render things.
This is Wenzel Jakob, an assistant professor of the IC school at EPFL.
This is done in so many places nowadays. So for instance, many people, they're actually quite surprised that when they don't realize that when they go on a webpage like IKEA or I think it's Adidas, many of the pictures that you see there of shoes or furniture, even quite large rooms that are filled with furniture, they're not photographs, they're actually renderings.
These days, computer graphics is not restricted to animated movies. These days, computer graphics is ubiquitous. But why? Why does the industry enjoy computer graphics so much?
So one thing that's kind of convenient about renderings and modeling things on a computer is that it's easy to go and make changes later on.
Computer graphics images can be more easily edited than photographic pictures.
So if you create an image and then you realize that you're not happy with it, you can just go in very easily and make a minor change and then just rerun the simulation again. And that's one thing that the movie industry, for instance, is quite fond of. Imagine you're building some complicated scene and you were actually building it physically and you film it, you invite the actors, you have everything recorded. But then afterwards, the director comes and says, well, I don't quite like the shading here in this corner. And, you know, there's this other thing. So now they have to rebuild everything, invite the actors back, etc. So that's really tedious. So this ability to make modifications is quite useful.
I can vouch for this. If there's even a tiny edit that's needed for a zettabytes video, I either have to find a clever trick to get around the troubling part of the video, for instance by displaying an image or an animation while redoing the off voice of a particular section, or I'd have to reshoot the entire video, because even if I have the same t-shirt and all, it's impossible to get my hair or the light to be exactly the same in two different recording sessions.
One thing that's really helpful, and that's also a topic that I'm quite interested in, is really to build upon this power to predict what things look like. So once you describe your scene carefully enough, you can really trust what the rendering algorithm produces. And so that's useful, for instance, if you're going to build or produce something that's potentially very expensive, you can really know exactly what it looks like. And so then you have confidence that it's a good idea to proceed.
Hmm. Could you give an example?
For instance, you know, imagine you're making a building and you want to be happy with the way it's illuminated inside. Computer graphics gives you this power of answering questions like, you know, given that the window is in this place and I'm using this special type of paint for my walls, on a November afternoon in the year 2017, is it going to be too dark, or maybe I should move the window a little bit to the side? So those kinds of things can be simulated, and if you do it carefully enough, then you can really trust the results of that.
Computer graphics can allow you to see different light effects under different conditions for your building, even though your building only exists in your mind. This is so cool. But applications are not restricted to architecture.
There are so many companies that are building all sorts of fancy devices nowadays that are mostly built in China. So you can make a design and then decide to build it. So there, at that point, there's a big pipeline that usually is done in Shenzhen that needs to start up and actually produce what you proposed, say on Kickstarter or so. And that's really expensive and it takes a long time. So if you can iterate many times beforehand, then that's quite useful.
In particular, for companies whose products have been digitally designed, representing the objects using computer graphics represents a small additional cost.
If you have a whole pipeline that works with three-dimensional data that you already use to design your products, then you have all the data already in a convenient form that you can then go and make images that you put into your web shop or into advertisement material.
Applications of computer graphics in the industry are thus plentiful, but applications go way beyond the industrial world.
Another application is cultural heritage preservation. So there are many cultural artifacts in museums, for instance, that are quite fragile. So we can look at them now, but they're slowly disintegrating over time because of exposure to light, humidity changes, etc.
In particular, the digitalization of cultural artifacts done here is not a mere photographic picture. This digitalization also records how the cultural artifact will behave when lit and observed in different manners.
Computer graphics also offers ways of completely capturing the visual information of an object so that if it does end up being destroyed over the decades or centuries, then at least we still have this information, which is a visual record of what it looks like from, let's say, any position of observation.
Finally, I could not leave Professor Jakob without asking him about video games.
So for video games, the constraints are a little bit different. For video games, there are really just a few milliseconds that you have to produce one image before it has to be drawn on the screen. So that kind of limits your ability to do very fancy computations. So that's a little bit different from the type of research that I normally do, where I'm willing to spend at least a few minutes on computing a single image. But graphics cards are getting faster at a tremendous pace. So it is indeed the case that many of the things that have been developed in the context of realistic rendering, so this slower kind of rendering, are now slowly making their ways into graphics engines that are used for computer games. So there's a healthy exchange between these areas.
How do we get what is essentially a super powerful adding machine, a computer, to generate a photorealistic rendering? Well, the answer to that question is math.
If they had just had a single machine, they would have needed to start rendering before the dawn of the Egyptian civilization to finish in time for the release of the movie.